electric potential is equal by definition to the potential energy per unit charge. So you take the change in the potential energy, divide that by Q, you get the potential energy per unit charge. This new quantity is called potential. So you have potential and you have potential energy. Potential means potential energy per unit charge. To minimize confusion, we call this electric potential, most of the time we call it voltage. Because of that, you see the letter V here, voltage. Voltage is the same as electric potential, and it simply means the energy per unit charge. So in the SI system, energy per unit charge is joule per coulomb. This unit in the SI system is called volt. 1 volt is equal to 1 joule per coulomb. It is the work per unit charge that would have to be done by some force to move a charge from point A to point B in the electric field. So we can calculate that using the previous information that we just discussed. The change in potential energy is negative the work, which is minus Q E dx, divide that by Q, Q cancels with the Q, so this is minus Ex delta X. So this is the electric potential or voltage. E multiplied by delta X is equal to delta V. This is an important relationship that allows us to calculate the change in the voltage from the change in position. Okay, the change in the voltage from the change in the position. Presumably, the field is uniform, is constant. Another unit from this equation that we can also use is 1 newton per coulomb. That is for the electric field. We can This way, we can calculate the electric field from this equation as 1 volt per meter, 1 volt per meter, which is identical to the unit that we learned last chapter for the electric field, which is 1 newton per coulomb. These two units are identical and both are using SI units. If a negatively charged particle is placed at rest in an electric potential field that increases in the positive x direction, what will happen? The particle will accelerate in the positive x direction, accelerate in the negative x direction, remain at rest. So as we have in mechanics, if you are holding an object with mass m in your hand and you let go, the object will move down. So in this case, because the charge is negative, it will be attracted to the positive side or it will accelerate in the positive x direction. If the charge was positive, it will accelerate in the negative x direction to reduce the potential energy, just like the behavior of an object with mass m as it falls down to reduce the potential energy. The figure below is a graph of an electric potential as a function of position. Electric potential or voltage as a function of position. If a positively charged particle is placed at point A, so it is positively charged at point A, what will its subsequent motion be? Okay, as I was talking about the object with mass m, here the charge will move to reduce the potential energy. And in order to do that, it will move to the left because this is less potential energy. Okay. So, in general, the charged particle will tend to move toward positions of lower potential energy. Just think of how masses behave in a gravitational electric field. Masses will move downward, not upward, if you let go. And that is just the trend toward positions of lower potential energy. Whether it is a gravitational field or electric field, it's the same behavior. Both are conservative fields. If a negatively charged particle is placed at point B in the figure below and given a very small kick to the right, what will its subsequent motion be? So this is a negatively charged particle. And here, this is an equilibrium position. If you invert this, imagine you are having a mass that is in such an inverted curve like this, going this way. If you give them slight displacement either way, it will bounce back and forth around the equilibrium position, the position of minimum potential energy. This is exactly what will happen here. This is the equilibrium position, the position of minimum energy for a negative charge. If it was positive, it will be inverted downward. So a negatively charged particle would oscillate around x equals b, which is a position of minimum potential energy for negative charges. We are all familiar with this. In your car, in my car, all cars will have a battery inside. And the battery, the standard for the car battery is 12 volt. That is the voltage difference between the positive electrode and the negative electrode of the battery. Okay? Any car battery, you will have a voltage difference, a potential difference between the two electrodes, the positive electrode and the negative electrode, that is equal to 12 volt. So far, we learned about electric potential and electric potential energy, and we learned that the difference between them is just electric potential is potential energy per unit charge. Both are scalar quantities. So here, just to relate what we learned before, last chapter, to what we are learning today, you compare here in this graph the behavior of the electric field to the potential field, V. The magnitude of the electric field is inversely proportional with R squared. So you have this steep parabola. For the potential, the magnitude of the potential is inversely proportional with R. We still have this curve, but it is inverse proportionality with R rather than with R squared for the field. I have to remind you that the electric field is a vector while the electric potential is a scalar. We can calculate for a point charge, the electric potential is equal to KQ over R. So Q is the source for the electric potential field, just like Q is the source for the electric field. KE is the electrostatic constant, which is 9 by 10 to the power 9. So here you can see that both the electric field and the potential field both depends on two things, Q, which is the source of the field, and R, which is the position in the field. And we have this inverse dependence on R for V and inverse dependence on R squared for E. If you have several charges, then we apply the superposition principle. You calculate the potential or the field for each one, and then you just add the fields together. That would be a vector sum. If it's potential, you add the potentials together. That would be an algebraic sum because potential is a scalar. In three dimensions, this is how the electric potential looks. So here when you have a positive potential going up this way, and if it's negative potential going down this way, this is an independence on R. R, remember, is the distance from the source, from the charge, to the location where we are trying to measure the potential. So here, if you have this point charge, Q1, at a distance R, the electric potential due to Q1 is equal to KQ1 over R. Okay? This is the electric potential due to this charge. Now, if you bring another charge, Q2, place it at this location, now you have potential energy, not electric potential, potential energy, which is a property of the system, a property of both charges. The potential energy is KQ1 Q over R. Okay. Comparing this information to this information, you can deduce that the potential energy is equal, in fact, to V1 multiplied by Q2. V1 multiplied by Q2. This would be the potential energy. So the potential is a property of a single charge, but the potential energy is a property of two charges. It depends on the relative position for the two charges. Check your understanding. A spherical balloon contains a positively charged particle at its center. As the balloon is inflated to a larger volume, while the charged particle remains at the center, which of the following is true? The electric potential at the surface of the balloon increases. That's not correct, because as the volume increases, R increases, and as R increases, the electric potential decreases, not increases. So this is not correct. The magnitude of the electric field at the surface of the balloon increases. There is no reason to increase the electric field. So this is not correct. Three, the electric flux through the balloon remains the same. Yes, this is correct. From Gauss, that we learned in chapter 15, from Gauss law, the flux depends on the enclosed charge. The enclosed charge remains the same, so the flux remains the same. The strategy to solve a problem dealing with electric potential usually is to sketch the problem. Use the information given to you to sketch a diagram, and then calculate and label distances. For each charge, you calculate the potential, KQ over R, and then you just sum, algebraic sum, the potentials in order to determine the total electric potential.